This one, let's not get to the results to the end, but this is the title of it is Impact of Post-Exercise Fructose Maltodextrin Ingestion on Subsequent Endurance Performance. So what were you trying to find out with this study?
So this was a follow-up of a previous study that we did in our lab. So let's first dig into the background a bit. So we have three different monosaccharides, which is glucose, fructose, and galactose. There is very little known about galactose, so let's put this one aside and let's talk about fructose and glucose. Glucose can be utilized by most body cells. So we are talking about like glucose in the blood all the time, like 5 millimoles is the normal concentration of the glucose in the blood. And it's really important for the brain. It's really important for muscles. But then we also have fructose. And fructose cannot be utilized by most body cells. So fructose first needs to enter the liver where it's metabolized. The most important pathway or like what happens with fructose is it's converted to glycogen during the recovery, liver glycogen, and part of it goes out of the liver in the form of glucose or lactate. So if you're actually eating candies that have a lot of like fructose in them, you're going to actually increase the lactate levels even at rest, which is kind of really interesting thing. It doesn't happen only during exercise, but also at rest. And studies in the past have shown, actually my supervisor in the early 2000s, or I think the study was published in 2008, that when you combine glucose and fructose during the post-exercise recovery period, you get the same amount of glycogen, muscle glycogen replenishment after the exercise. So you deplete first deplete glycogen stores, so the carbohydrate stores within the body, and then you do a repletion by having loads of carbohydrates in the subsequent few hours. And they have found that the rate of muscle glycogen replenishment is the same whether you ingest only glucose or glucose and fructose. Then the other studies found out that when it comes to liver glycogen, which is the organ that maintains the normal glucose concentrations in the blood, the liver concentrations were much higher after the ingestion or co-ingestion of fructose and glucose, because fructose first needs to go to the liver, be metabolized there, whereas glucose, most of it goes straight to the muscle. So in the end, if you're ingesting glucose and fructose, you end up having more glycogen stored, especially in the liver, and there is no chance in the muscle. So the question was, does this translate into improved performance? So like that would be really cool thing to do, especially like riders that train day to day and they have a limited amount of time between two training sessions. That's probably like very interesting for triathletes, but also like for elite athletes, like Tour de France riders, because the timing between two sessions is pretty short. And we wanted to see if this translates into improved exercise capacity or performance. So the first study was published a few years ago by our group, where we asked runners to run until exhaustion at 70% of VO2 max. So they were running for like quite some time. And by the end of this, after the end of this exercise bout number one, we fed them with 90 grams of glucose only, or glucose and fructose for 4 hours. 90 grams per hour, and then we ask them to run again until exhaustion. And in the group, I mean, in the condition when they got a combination of fructose and glucose, the time to exhaustion was much greater than when they only got glucose. And we kind of, this was kind of the first study showing that there might be some benefit from co-ingestion of glucose and fructose. However, the problem with that study was that we were doing the exercise capacity test. So how long can you go at a certain intensity? This is not what happens during the race because in a race, you have to cover certain distance. So it's a completely different story. So we kind of wanted to really improve the study design by measuring performance. And the other thing we were interested in was also substituting running with cycling, because it was thought that perhaps the fructose-glucose combination was better because there was less gastrointestinal discomfort. Because, you know, like runners experience much more, the discomfort is more prevalent among runners. And we thought that the better like exercise mode to investigate the pure effects of like ingestion of different sugars is cycling, because the prevalence of gastrointestinal discomfort is much lower. So we did this study. And in the meantime, actually, the first study was kind of replicated by the researchers at University of Bath, where they like replicated the results. They got much better or higher time to exhaustion in cycling. So they did the same, exactly almost the same study, but not in running, but in cycling. And they found very similar results as we did. But in the meantime, we were doing also an hour study, which was a bit different in protocol. So we used, instead of time to exhaustion as a glycogen depletion mode, we did a high intensity interval training session. So it was like a really intense 2 minute.
Tim, I want to walk you through each one of those, because I want to get into very specific parts of it. But you said a whole bunch of really important things there. So I want to wrap, I want to like pull out a few of those. One, you mentioned about gastrointestinal issues. And this podcast is probably mostly cyclists from TrainerRoad users, but there are probably, hopefully, runners and rowers and all sorts of other type of endurance athletes. And you hear a lot about people say, hey, I just can't take in that much carbohydrate while I'm working out. And usually what you see is people do, you look at what they're eating and it's mostly glucose. And if you're doing like 100 grams of glucose, in general, a lot of people have issues with that. And what you're saying is that if you combine it with fructose, and there's a ratio, and I think we can talk about ratios. Actually, just tell us, is there a ratio between glucose and fructose that you think is better for people's stomach?
Yeah, I think the current research indicates that the best ratio is close to unity, a bit more glucose than fructose. But yeah, it's kind of like during exercise, we know that you can actually only utilize up to like 60 or 66 grams of glucose-based carbohydrates per hour. So glucose is also like behaves in the similar way as maltodextrin that is usually present in most energy drinks or gels. And then we have fructose as well. And the difference between glucose and fructose here is that the transporters that transport these sugars from the intestine into the bloodstream are different between are different for fructose and glucose. So when you saturate the transporters for glucose, and this happens at like 60, 66 grams per hour, you can still utilize those transporters for fructose, and you can actually probably uptake more of this sugar. And that's why energy gels, certain energy gels, like power gels or Morton, also have fructose in their products, because this can help with the absorption. And they're also like usually friendlier to the stomach.
So you're getting power from two sources at once, pretty much.
Yeah.
So I have a question too. This is a little bit off topic, but no one's been able to answer this question for me. The 66 grams per hour just showed research. People are such different sizes. You take a 5 foot, 100 pound woman and a 6'5 Michael Phelps, who's training a whole bunch. His intestines are bigger. I'm 6'6 myself. Is it the same if I'm a little, if I'm, you know, 100 pounds versus if I'm 200 pounds, the 66, do we know that? Has there been research around that?
Not really. So we only have indirect data. So Oscar Yeokinju was performed, like he performed many studies looking at this, into this like topic about exogenous carbohydrate oxidation rates. So how much carbohydrates that you're ingesting, you're actually oxidizing. And he did many studies in Birmingham, and he pulled up the data from all of those studies together and found no relationship. but we have to know that there was no specific study. So, for example, Matthew Heyman, he's a really tall guy. He can produce a lot of power, can probably, I would imagine, uptake and utilize more carbohydrates than, I don't know, Nayira Quintana, a really small, tiny guy.
Yeah, and Heyman's like 180, right? Like, and Quintana's like 130 maybe. So the amount of just power outputting, you would think that if you're limited by the 66, that all the big people would just drop off, right? Because they couldn't be restoring their glycogen in these bigger races. Okay, so that's something else that we can, that would be a really cool study, by the way, if you get someone, especially if someone who is really taking a lot of carbohydrate, because I wonder too if there's something in the gut that changes if you're habitually taking in whole bunch of glucose on rides over many years. But my next question is, if you do take more, what happens? So let's say like you're just a regular person and you start taking in 200 grams of glucose per hour. What happens? So if you only absorb 66, what happens to the rest?
It's just sitting there and waiting for the end of exercise, and then it will just probably be transported at the time. So for example, I was doing a lot of experiments on my own in the lab, and I was doing once a ride with 120 grams per hour, and that was kind of a lot. It was 1-to-1 ratio of fructose glucose, which I thought was optimal, and I think I reached like 1.6 or 1.7 grams per minute oxidation rate, so that's way below 120 grams that I was ingesting per hour. And at the end of the ride, I wasn't really tired when I stopped. I wasn't craving food, although I was cycling for 3 hours at 250 watts. I was just normal. I just went to the office and started working because I didn't feel tired at all. And I think like the blood glucose was normalized as soon as I stopped, just because there was still plenty of carbohydrates available.
If you like this video, make sure you give us a thumbs up.
If you didn't like this video, you can give it a thumbs down, but let us know what you would have done differently in the comments below.
If you want to see more of these videos, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. And if you want to become a faster cyclist, check out trainerroad.com.
Do it.
If you think I have better hair than Jonathan, give it a thumbs up. If not, leave a comment.
My hair is better than his.